Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Fall of Princes by Robert Goolrick. Read by R.C. Bray. Chapter 1. The Invention of Money. When you strike a match, it burns brighter in the first nanosecond than it will ever burn again. That first incandescence, that instantaneous and brilliant flash. The year was 1980, and I was the match, and that was the year I struck into blinding flame. I was a heat-seeking missile, headed straight for your gut. Get out of the way, or I would take you down, I swear. I'm not proud of it. In fact, I flush with shame at the memory. But that was then, what then was like. Things are very different now. I'm not that person anymore. Then I was the still, hot point of light at the end of the matchstick on which everything and everybody converged. I could be seen clearly from outer space, a hot, bright whiteness moving without guilt or pity through the hottest, brightest city in the world, and if you happened to be on a spacewalk on any given night, you could have had a front-row seat to my public chicaneries and my private excesses. Under the $1,000 duvet, on the $15,000 mattress, in the marble-tiled shower, slipping into a bespoke black cashmere jacket on a snowy winter night, I was unmistakable in my vast illumination. Thousands of hours in the world's most expensive gym, with the world's most skilled trainers, had brought my body to such a state of perfection that the women who rushed to take off their clothes in my bedroom could only gasp at the luck that had put them into my line of sight. That had made them, even for one night, the most beautiful creatures on earth, with their lithe arms and their skin like chamois and their scents, God, their scents, and their golden manes of hair falling on their shoulders, sweeping my chest. A glance was all it took from me. They could feel the heat. The hunger grew before they even knew my name, and they didn't care. They didn't care if I was an axe murderer or the Bishop of Lyon. B.S.D. That was the phrase somebody coined to describe us and only us. Big, swinging dick. And it stuck. And we wore that sobriquet like a badge of honor. And we sold our junk bonds and our trash securities and made $100,000 every microsecond of every minute, the match flaring into atomic glow, lighting up our faces, our ruddy cheeks, our glinting eyes, our megawatts of greed and glory and rapaciousness. My feet, solidly on the ground in shoes from John Lobb in London, my legs mammoth, able to press 300 pounds, able to leap tall buildings at a single bound, the rest going on from there. The powerful hips and haunches, connected to a stomach as flat and hard as a frozen lake, yet hot to the touch. And they didn't care if they got burned or scarred for life, like junkies who can't stop until all the dope is gone, knowing that there is no more, that the withdrawal will be agony but not caring, yearning only for the sharp prick of the needle of my incandescent self. I say this without pride or apology. It is a statement of irrefutable fact. I could charm a hatchling out of its egg. I could sell ice cream to Eskimos. Dead Eskimos. And we worked. We worked our asses off. Before we came into the world, fully armed like Pallas Athene, work had somehow gone out of fashion. The men and women had become sluggish, their expectations limited, the horizon they had once envisioned lined with palaces and gorgeous objects of all kinds had become nothing more than a thin line in a rapidly approaching distance, the place they would end up neither richer nor wiser, filled only with regret and second-tier liquor and the shreds of the dreams they no longer even remembered, surprised to wake up one day and be shown the door with a tepid handshake and a future on the edge of old age and death that held only pictures of the kids and grandkids, a cruise to some out-of-season destination every 3 years, and the notion, which they somehow managed to believe, that this was comfort, that this was all the splendor they got for 40 years of relentless drudgery and obsequiousness. And to all of this, we said, fuck you, we want it all. We want it now. You can drain us of our blood for all we care, but we want impossible things of impossible vintage and provenance. We want salaries equivalent to our ages multiplied by 100,000. We want to live life in a rush of fury and light, to rampage, to pillage our neighborhoods and rape and demolish our best and closest friends, and we were secure in this, knowing that if we all wanted the same thing, everybody would get equally glorified and decimated. We were magnificent in our generosity and stingy with our secret selves. We sang the executioner song on our way to the office in the hour before dawn, and we spent our days playing high-stakes one-on-one basketball with other people's money in darkened rooms with no clocks, so there was no compass, no marker, save for the hum of money, with other young men just like us, our inner lives obscured by insatiable greed, and we let our increasingly dubious virtues grow tangled and overgrown with layer after layer of objects. Things, always things. Suits that cost more than our fathers had paid for their first houses. Cars of exuberant finesse, and the mountains of speeding tickets we got racing out to the east end of Long Island, where we kept the pools heated year-round. We slept like babies at night. And I walked through these crowds of men, all of whom wanted exactly what I wanted, and I beat them down until I was a colossus. And rather than inspire fear and loathing, they adored me. They wanted and sought my company, knowing that I would slam dunk them off the court every single time, and then, like an abusive father, I would shower them with presents, gold watches, cashmere sweaters, and the gift of my smile, the perfect teeth, wholly created by Dr. Greg Latucci of Central Park South. It was going to end. It had to. The worm would, in fact, devour its own tail, eat its own heart out. But that was of no consequence. Not then. Not at that time. Not to me. Want to know how I got my job? How it all began? It wouldn't happen this way today. Today you'd be hired based on some secret CEO algorithm that takes into account your best in show at Wharton, your height and your wingspan, the charitable work you did in Guatemala when you were 16, your ethnic variety. Or maybe you're hired these days just because you haven't committed a major felony yet. In those days, in the year of my incandescence, to get one of the most coveted jobs on Wall Street, you played poker. Winner take all. Job or no job, based solely on your ability to beat the CEO at a hand of cards. That's not how it begins now, not by a long shot. But then, one hand of poker is what sealed the deal. It begins when you're in graduate school. You are courted, warily, at a distance. You feel them circling, and then they come closer. You can feel them breathing down your neck. You feel gifted, blessed, chosen. Then they strike, second year. You get the call that everybody in your class has been waiting for. The firm. The legend and the gravitas and the money are on the other end of the line, and they are speaking to you in a polite, reserved tone of voice. So much is unspoken. So much unsaid but known. You are invited to New York to work your guts out for one summer, doing the drudge work, crunching numbers for 18 hours a day. It is understood you will not be paid. This is never said. You pack your bags. You are met at the train station by a young woman, snugly filling a sober but chic suit, knowing she will never get far in what was then an almost all-male world. She got a 4.0 at the Darden School. Every minute of her life, she has been the smartest person in the room, and to 23, she is already facing a dead end. The certain knowledge that however well she does, there is no future for her except a line in bold type on a resume. She will never be paid what the boys are paid, but in the end, she will be fine. She will move to Chase by 25, where her every move will be applauded, the hinges of every door oiled to a whispering forgiveness by that one line in bold type that says she worked at the firm, however briefly. She will retire with a ton of bucks and a solid collection of good jewelry and the husband and the three children and the house in Greenwich. Now, she meets interns. Fresh-faced, totally ignorant, crisp as a newly minted bill. She arranges for a porter, although you insist you don't need one. There is a way things are done in this world, and that way, even though you are a meaningless blob of nothingness, does not include carrying your own luggage. She leads you to a black town car, the first of hundreds, thousands of such cars you are to come to know, to take as your due. This, at the firm, is what they call public transportation. You are taken to an apartment in Murray Hill that you do not know then is the dreariest neighborhood in the whole of New York. Dark, drab Murray Hill, and you are led into a large and pristine apartment where you are to spend the summer with three other guys who only yesterday were snapping each other's butts with wet towels in the locker rooms of the finest schools in the world, but who now stand in cordovan bluchers polished to sanctity and pinstriped suits, their faces eager with greed and fear. Many are called, but few are chosen, and you all know that. Know also that most of you will never make it. Will work your ass off for free for a single summer, and then go back to the books and wait for a phone call that does not ever come. This is where it begins, this sizing up, the eyeing of the jugular. Then the real courtship begins. You have never been fawned over. You are now. You are watched, and the watchers are swooning. They love you with an adoration that is both sensual and pragmatic. You are merely another potential ROI to them, but you feel their love, their lust for what you can do for them. You grow taller, stronger, handsomer. You have your shoes polished every day. You arrive every morning so pressed, so starched, that you could shave with the edge of your shirt collar, and by 11 you are a rumpled wreck because that only makes them love you more, the dishevelment of relentless labor. They take you around the harbor on Malcolm Forbes's boat, the Highlander. White-coated waiters bring you icy, sweating Heinekens as the Statue of Liberty serenely observes this year's crop of immigrants, and you want to get shit-faced, but you don't, and you want to sleep with the trim women, but you don't, out of fear that their inevitable doom and departure will leave you scarred, will infect you with their own failure. 1 in 100 of them will make it into the firm. 1 in 1,000 will make it upstairs. 1 in 1,000,000 has the mark of the BSD. Unfair? Maybe. But you didn't make the rules. They take you to the theater, center orchestra, on the aisle, to watch ludicrous spectacles for which not one single ticket is available for the next 2 years. They take you to Yankee Stadium, to Shea, where the heroes of your childhood are so close you can see the stubble on their chins. You see Madonna at the Garden. This girl who has caught the zeitgeist and sucked the world into the profound depth of her vagina. This BSD chick who seems to look into your eyes only, and she opens her mouth and electrifies you with her power, as though she would not fade, like Cleopatra, not ever. As though the strike of the match was for her and only her. An infinity. There are 20 interviews. Formal. Identical, except for the fact that the offices get larger each time you are called to trot out your brilliant resume. You speak of nothing else but your ambition. They talk about the culture of success, a culture you must not only thrive in, you must become historical. The questions get more pointed, more personal, with every interview. Do you do drugs? Have you ever cheated on a test? Lied to the IRS? Are you a homosexual? What do you dream about while you sleep? Do you ever have thoughts of suicide? Patently illegal questions even then, but you answer. And you will tell the truth, because you know they already know the answers and would spot a lie a mile off. It's like being tested for rabies, except that in this case they're only looking for positive results. Only the rabid dogs, the ones who have been starved and beaten with chains, teeth filed to ice picks, killer dogs to be put in the ring to kill other dogs, only these pass the interviews and move on to the next, bigger room. Do you hate your parents? Have you ever gotten a girl pregnant? What did you do about it? How often do you masturbate? Would you consider that excessive? You feel as though you are standing naked at Dachau, inspected by uniformed Gestapo who are deciding which line you are to join. And everybody smiles through it all. Everybody speaks in a kind, almost loving voice as they invade your every orifice, begin the arduous task of taking over your mind and melding it into what they repeatedly call the culture of the firm. 40 or 40, they say with a smile. 40 or 40. Excuse me? That's when you retire, they reply with that bland smile. When you reach the age of 40, or your portfolio reaches 40 million, that's when you can get away clean and get your life back. What's left of it? Bulls make money, they say. Bears make money. Pigs get slaughtered. They tell you these things, and you instantly know in your heart what they mean. And it speaks to your heart and your gut in a way no voice ever has. They tell you these things and you believe them. You can reach into your pocket and feel the weight of $40 million, not even a hint of gray at your temples yet, and your life stretching before you, the golden door, the brilliant road, the Ithaca, as Cavafy wrote, to which you have journeyed all these years. The summer ends, they shake your hand, and say they will see you again, although everybody knows this is only marginally true. In November, the call comes. Tickets are sent, first class. The train station, the porters, and the trim and futureless girl, the black car that drives you all the way downtown to the black glass tower where the black car pulls into a group of black cars just like it, lined up around the block three deep. This is your future. Or it isn't. You walk with confidence into the CEO's office. Your handshake is warm, your hands dry, your grip so firm the muscles on your forearm ripple as you take it all in, the sleek desk with nothing on it. The model of the yacht he undoubtedly owns. 120 feet of yar. His $20,000 watch. The bespoke suit. The look back into your eyes that says he likes you, but would nevertheless kill you without the slightest hesitation. Your coat is taken by one of his 8 secretaries. A young woman who looks as though she is the princess of a not minor European country. And the coat is put on a hanger, as though it is in an exhibit in a museum, and whisked out of sight. The office has been decorated by Mark Hampton to look like a drawing room in an English country house, and you know instantly that no business is ever done here, that all of that takes place somewhere else, so that nothing in this chintz and mahogany world is ever disturbed by so much as a raised voice. On the desk once owned by Napoleon is a single thing, a deck of cards, on which the seal has not even been broken. "The furniture is real," he says. "Try not to stick your gum on it." "My resume," you say, reaching into your portfolio from T. Anthony. "Fuck that," he says. "Your resume has been seen more times than Gone with the Wind. You're not the smartest, you're not the dumbest. I know everything about you. I know you slept with Suzanne Martin, who was much smarter than you and who no longer works here." "No, resumes are for other people. Here's what's going to happen," he says. "We're going to play a hand of poker. One hand. You win, you get a job. You lose, sayonara." "Yes, sir." "At the end of the game, you will be given your coat and you will leave. On your way out, you will be given a box. Inside the box, there will be a Mont Blanc pen. You will also be given a notebook. Once you leave, you will sign your name in the book. The ink will be either blue or black. All contracts are signed in blue ink. We're going to play an unusual version of Showdown. Rare, but not unheard of. I am going to lay all 52 cards face up on the desk. Total transparency. That, too, is part of the culture you may or may not be entering. You pick first. You can pick any 5 cards you want. After we've drawn, we both can discard and replace as many cards as we want once we've seen both our hands. But I have to tell you, there is a hand, one hand and only one hand, that will ensure that you win, no matter what I pick. Ready? "Yes, sir." We both stare at the cards laid out so neatly, 4 straight rows of 13 on Napoleon's desk. Suddenly it comes to me. I wait, brow furrowed, then tentatively reach out, withdraw, and finally pick. I want to show uncertainty, although I know already I've won the bet. In less than a minute, I'll be one of them. Is it even what I want? I don't know. In that moment, I feel the music lessons, the life drawing classes, the college theatricals, the self I had meant to be. I had wanted to be an artist, to express something that was inside me that needed to be said. The fact that I hadn't a clue as to what that thing was didn't deter me at all in the beginning. I worked hard and was terrible at everything. I wrote a bad novel, painted bad pictures, plotted through plays, parts I could speak but never inhabit, until I had had enough and I decided if I couldn't be eloquent, at least I could be rich. Beauty was too ephemeral and elusive. Money, that year, was the most tangible avatar of the zeitgeist, and not to grab it would be to miss the common experience of your generation. I thought it would protect me from the disappointment I felt in my own many and varied failures. I couldn't be what I wanted to be, a maker of beauty. And so I took my father's advice and went to business school, and caught it like a fever, the pulse of the money that was being made in my country, and I wanted in, because no place else would have me. I could, I thought, work among them and not become one of them. I was sensitive, poetic, and vulnerable to life's beauty. And now I sat on the other side of a desk that once belonged to Napoleon, one draw of the cards away from the devil. I hated abandoning the dreams of my youth, but in that second, the one thing I want is to win. I draw four tens and the three of hearts. I would learn to play the cello when I was old and finished with all of this. Paint watercolors of seascapes out of season. Act in local theater companies, playing the small parts, the butler, the next-door neighbor. Grease paint and footlight bows. The man looks at me across the desk. He smiles and draws a 9-high straight flush, spades in a row, ostensibly beating my 4 of a kind, but I know and he knows he can't get a straight flush higher than mine because I have all the 10s. I've blocked him by drawing them all. 9 is as high as he can go. He knows it too. Not that anything, shows in his face. He's done this hundreds of times. I discard everything but the 10 of hearts and draw the jack, queen, king, and ace of hearts for a royal flush. We stare at each other for a long time. The game is done. The cards are laid on the desk without a word from either of us. That concludes the interview. Thank you for coming. We stand, shake hands. He is either my new boss or just someone I met in an ostentatious office in my youth. The secretary hands me a box wrapped in white paper with a white satin ribbon making a bow. She also hands me a notebook of blank pages, bound in leather, with the firm's name embossed at the top and my name embossed in small letters in the lower right-hand corner. My name is spelled correctly. Good luck, she says, as she has said 1,000 times before. I wait until I'm on the train before I open the box. I take out the black and gold pen with the familiar logo on the cap and open the notebook and sign my name in royal blue ink. Pay attention. You can hear the match strike. You can smell the sulfur. And I allow myself the slightest smile as the train pulls out of the station through the dark tunnels and into the brilliance of the future. Chapter 2. Belated. Forgive me. I try not to think about the past very much, the way it was and isn't anymore. I try to, you know, go with the flow and live my life as it's handed to me. But sometimes I wake from a dream and I can't help it. The past washes over me like the tides, and along with the tides comes a sense of mortification so profound I feel it in my scrotum, like when you're thinking about the likelihood of having your teeth drilled. Forgive me for thinking that I was better than you will ever be. Forgive me for thinking that money equaled a kind of moral superiority. Forgive me for not thinking enough about the plight of the poor, the terrible lassitude that overtakes them the moment their feet hit the floor. The poor only bet on losing horses. They only give up things they never get until there's nothing left to part with, nothing of any value except for a faded photograph of their mother and father's wedding, a small figurine given to them on the boardwalk on one happy day in a lifetime of unending sameness. And they never look at the fiber content of the clothes they buy at Walmart. And they have a fear of running out of things, out of butter, out of sugar, out of laundry detergent. And they suffer nothing but one humiliation after another, and they buy scratchers with their welfare money at the gas station, and they never win a dime. For poor people, it's always Christmas Eve. Alone. Christmas never comes. And then there's AIDS, or the homeless, who wait for the volunteers to come and dish out a bland Thanksgiving dinner, or food stamps, or bad teeth, or being ugly. Forgive me for thinking that these were things that happened to other people on another planet. Forgive me, blonde girl, for going to the men's room between dinner and dessert, stopping to pay the check with the maitre d', grabbing my coat and walking out of the restaurant on a snowy February night to hail a cab and go to a loud, hot room where the people were more attractive. How long did you sit there? How long did you endure the pity and condescension of the waiters? How did it feel to leave the restaurant and stand with the snow falling and nowhere to go? The careful makeup, the sequined dress, all for nothing in the night, for this insult, and barely enough money in your purse to get home to your flat crowded with girls just like you. You had perfect legs. The curve of your breasts beneath the gauzy dress was sublime. You paid $300 to have your hair colored, and for what? To be left alone in the middle of the restaurant of the week by a man who doesn't even remember your name? By a man who never gave it a second thought? Until the lonely nights descended without expiation. Who told the story later over and over, as though it were some joke and you were the punchline. Forgive me for thinking that sitting courtside at the Knicks at 400 a pop, 3 seats away from Spike Lee, was a useful way of spending money. Forgive me for thinking that meeting a movie star was the same as knowing movie stars, perhaps the most unknowable people on Earth. The truth is, I had no deep respect and took no pride in what I did. I just did it for fun and the high, the restless high roll of it all, and so the money I made meant nothing to me. There was no time, no future. There were only piles of cash. I felt no particular compunction about manipulating the hopes of people less fortunate than myself, people who would never hold the reins of a Derby winner in their hands as I did every day, all day long. It's 3 a.m., and sleep will not come. There were too many ghosts in the room. I don't dwell in the past, as I said, but tonight I'm there again, right there, with the roll and the flow and the vulgar indiscretions and the unbridled narcissism of it all. I'm buried in guilt and remorse. I am overcome with rage that the past is over irrevocably, that I have my laundry done at the wash and fold, that I know exactly how much it costs to buy a pint of half and half for my coffee, that the men and women I spent so many years with are lost to me forever. The darlings of my youth. They speak a different language. I have forgotten the way, the argot, the inflection. I am sad that the places I used to drink and dance and eat and whore are now just numbers in somebody else's file of facts. I see the past. I feel its addictions. But the faces are indistinct and the voices are mute. The past is the only place you come home to one day to find the locks changed, the rooms stripped of furniture, of every object from which you had derived such ridiculous amounts of self-esteem. Do they ever think of me? I doubt they do. There are, after all, more interesting topics. Success has a million musical nuances. Failure is only the monotonous banging of a brass gong. Forgive me, French girl I met while she was bathing topless on the beach at the Delano Hotel. Frank bet me I couldn't fuck her by 10 o'clock. Bet me $100 I couldn't have sex with her by the time we met for dinner. And I showed up at 10 with the girl on my arm and said, "You lose." And Frank gave me $100 right in front of her. She was staying at a cheesy motel, and she'd only come to the Delano to meet nice, rich men. Men like me. When I put her on the plane, she looked at me with fear. Forgive me for thinking I was good-hearted. I wasn't. For thinking even now that nevertheless God has a special place in his heart for me, that there is a reason for all this suffering. Forgive me for thinking that black limousines were public transportation. This night will last forever. I am locked in the darkness until the end of time. I have reached the age of regret, and forgive me my hour of lamentation and self-pity. We used to go to this sports bar all the time, where we would eat bad food and drink endless cocktails and dip the tips of our cigars in snifters of Remy and watch sports on TV. We played a game, night after night, for a while. The game was called To Have and To Have Not. The idea was you had to think of something you had done that nobody else at the table had done, or something you had never done that everybody else had done. You had to tell the truth. It was understood. If you could think of something that made you unique, everybody toasted you and took a drink, although since we were drinking pretty much constantly, the toasts were pretty much pro forma. The early nights, the entries were mostly sexual. I've had sex on the pitcher's mound at the University of Denver. Unremarkably enough, her fiancé blushingly had to admit that he had too. I've been in a three-way. Practically everybody. I've masturbated at a movie. In the theater or at home watching a porno. In the theater. It turns out, a lot of people have masturbated at the movies, mostly when they were teenagers. This is something that happens. The huge, glowing image, the sensual mouths, the whispered dialogue. Somehow it's all sexual, sitting in the dark. But once the usual sexual shenanigans were out of the way, the entries got both more commonplace and more fascinating. It took weeks until people's real distinguishing peculiarities began to appear, but when they did, it was pretty riveting. We would sit around all day trying to think of some minor detail of our lives that would make us drinkably unique. Dan said, "I've never been swimming, never even been in the water." Everybody drank. June said one night, "I've never tasted beer." And this was a woman who owned a Mexican restaurant and who could pack it away with the best of them. Teddy said, "I've never taken a photograph." We couldn't believe it. Then one night, after a long dry spell, I put out a surefire winner. "I've had sex with an animal." By this time, we were pretty much past the stage of being shocked at the vagaries of human behavior. But this did raise an eyebrow or two, and people started to lift their glasses when crisp, fastidious Teddy suddenly said, "So have I." Glasses down in general discussion of where and why and how it worked and so forth. But one of the rules by then was that nothing got discussed very much. You didn't have to explain yourself. You just had to stand out from the herd. It came to be my turn again, and I said, "I've had a girl kill herself because I dumped her." And Teddy again said, "So have I." And all discussions stopped, and we hardly ever played the game again. Too many cats were out of too many bags, and I had upped the ante beyond most people's willingness to reveal their secrets in the middle of a musty sports bar. Imagine two people having those same identical experiences. It's outside the realm of possibility or thought. Forgive me my callousness with the details of my life, with the intimacies of other people's. The girl who killed herself was tall. She was 24, so was I. We had been sweethearts in college, and then we had broken up while I went to business school, and then we had gotten together when we were both in the city. She got pregnant, and I paid for an abortion, and then I dumped her. I had just gone to work, thrilling in the fact that somebody paid you basically to play one-on-one basketball all day long, and I didn't want her around anymore. I wanted the world, but I didn't want her. She was too small. She was too fresh. She wrote me a note, which I still have, and then she slit her wrists in the bathtub. Her parents were deeply mournful and couldn't figure out why she had done it. I guess you never do. I never told them about the note or the pregnancy, or the many ways in which I had longed to be free of her. I can't even say her name. I remember everything about her. I remember her softness and her lightheartedness and the way she loved me. I remember her in my prayers, and there is no amount of forgiveness that will undo what I did. She was my last soft girlfriend, and I used her as a showstopper in a bar game. The child would be almost 30 by now, a fine young person, I imagine, with a whole clean life, like untracked snow. I would be a better person. I wouldn't be alone. There would be a card and a call on my birthday. In the middle of the night, I hear his voice. It's always him, never her. I wouldn't have known what to do with a girl. And he says, "Hi, Dad." A way of addressing your father my mother would have considered tacky, and I feel the warmth spreading in my heart. She was tall, as I said, the girl whose name I won't say, even to myself, even at 3 in the morning, in the dark, in my apartment, where everything speaks of loss, where everything I have reminds me of everything I used to have, as though there were still a gold Rolex on the night table, the key to a Mercedes CLK still on my bureau on its silver keychain from Tiffany's, the schnabel on the wall, whereas in actuality none of these things exist or exist in places to which I have no access, the vintage watch store window, the storage bins at Christie's, waiting for the market for schnabel to come back. Hi, Dad. How much that would have meant to me now. My birthday goes unmarked. I buy myself a birthday cake, even have it decorated with my name on top, and I have a slice after I eat my takeout sushi at the kitchen table. You still do these little things for yourself, because not to do them would mean you had simply ceased to exist. You have to pretend, when speaking to the ladies in the cake store, that the cake is for a friend. Pretend that you're giving a big party, so you need the cake that serves 20. And you sit at the kitchen table with this enormous and elaborate cake for 20 with your name written in fondant on the top, and you feel worse about yourself than you ever have in your life. But after the sushi box has been thrown out and the stray drops of soy sauce have been wiped from the formica tabletop and the dishes, what few there are, have been washed and put away because you have to hold on to some kind of order or you are lost altogether, You sit down and put a single candle on the cake you bought for yourself and light it and make a wish before blowing it out, and then you cut a big piece of the immense cake and you eat it and you sob as the too sweet dessert goes into your mouth. I buy myself a tie for my birthday and have it wrapped. And I open my present and mime surprise, all the while waiting for the phone to ring and the voice on the other end to say hi, Dad. I am so sorry. My sorrow is immense, bigger than the cake, gaudier than the paper wrapping the drab tie. I wash the plate and the fork and put them away, and then I put the rest of the cake back into the box and drop it down the garbage chute for the rats. Happy birthday, rats. Hi, Dad's tall mother, an inch taller than I am, and as beautiful as the Blue Ridge Mountains in April. And she had come to New York to be a ballerina, but her height had proved to be a problem. While dancing, she appeared to be not graceful, but merely astonishing, and nobody could figure out what to do with her. Even the great Balanchine was baffled. He tried. Her form, he said, was exquisite, but she towered over the boys, and the lifts always ended in some comic disaster, so he turned her away with his usual coldness. She was useless to him, and therefore of no interest, except possibly in bed, where he was already overbooked for the season. So she turned to modeling. She trudged the streets of the city with her portfolio, listening again and again to the list of her flaws. She shaved off her eyebrows in an attempt to separate herself from the other girls who, like her, were almost there but not quite. This did not make her more beautiful. It just gave her a look of continual surprise so that it seemed that everything that came out of your mouth was the most fascinating thing she had ever heard. The most beautiful feature of a beautiful woman is her skin. After all, that's what you touch. Her skin had a kind of clammy, plastic quality to it, so my desire for her was mixed with a kind of simultaneous repulsion. Sometimes, or at least sometimes in those days, I would find myself crazy with desire for a woman who also repelled me, and that would drive me to heights of lust unknown with ordinary women. Not that I slept with many ordinary women. I remember them all, every one, and I think of each of them every day and always with love and gratitude in my heart, so grateful that they would let me take off my clothes and lie next to them, actually to enter them and become one with their bodies. We squabbled all the time, and every time we had a fight, we would go and have our hair cut, so in our few moments of uneasy truce, between her look of shocked beauty and mine of profligate prosperity, we could pretty much stop traffic on any street corner, just for our gorgeous heads of hair alone, get past any velvet rope because we adorned any room we were in. I was crazy about her. I couldn't stand her most of the time, but I was crazy about her. As for her, she was high-strung, as my mother used to say, and almost impossible to live with. "You don't love me," she said one day. "But I do," I lied. "I do love you." "Well, you don't love me enough," she yelled back, and I thought to myself, "Define that, please. When is enough enough?" But for her, as they say in Texas, too much ain't enough. So we broke up. I had met a photographer, a rich, good photographer who looked in her retro way like Tamara Delimpichka. She lived on a large allowance from her mother, who had buckets of money from her second husband, and came to our relationship with Tiffany Silver for 24. And that Tiffany china that has a black border with chinoiserie painted around it also for 24. And I wanted her like the desert wants rain, and I broke up with the eyebrow girl. "We're turning into the kind of people I don't want to be," I said, and left her at her kitchen table, this time genuinely surprised. She had thought our life, fighting like two cats in a bag and then making love that would cause the angels to sing, was just fine. Photographer and I moved in together. Her mother was on everybody's best-dressed list, at least in Philadelphia, and she had an attic full of couture clothes dating back to the 50s and had Norman Norell's home number in her phone book, and the photographer spent her days taking magical pictures of her friends in her mother's clothes and showed them at a very prestigious gallery. She took my picture naked for my 30th birthday, and of all the girls and all the detritus of all those liaisons, it is the best of the souvenirs I keep. Just to look at it, and it all comes back to me, and I just stare and say I'm sorry, over and over and over. I owe them all my most sincere apology, but as occasionally happens, if I...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.